nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 118. So now we're going to jump into practical implementation of some of the ideas we talked about in the previous lectures using the program called MIT Photonic Bands. And so I'm going to walk you through how do you create a control file for MIT Photonic Bands, and then what kind of outputs might you expect to get. And then, of course, in later lectures, we'll go into more details about how that works. So to start off, all these control files are written in Scheme, which is a powerful functional language. We won't necessarily use the full capabilities of it, but it does enable us to do a lot of things like very easily. In this case, actually, it turns out we'll mainly just be defining variables and then running programs, but we can certainly do more if needed. And we'll show some more of the capabilities down the road. But for now, we'll basically just first do something very simple, which is to set the number of bands that we're calculating, remembering that if we use a smaller number of bands instead of the full possible number of bands, it'll give us a much faster computation. And that was like one of the original motivations for designing MPB in the first place. And then second, we'll actually recall the previous band structures that we had shown, and then recall that there are these special k points, which are gamma, x, and m values. And then we're going to basically set up something that would walk through all these special k points that corresponds to the irreducible Brillouin zone for a square lattice. And so in this case, we go from gamma to x, where kx is equal to pi over a, to m, where kx and ky are that value, and then back to gamma, where all k's are equal to zero. And then we also add this interpolation function, which gives us this extra set of four k points that are in between each of those special k points. And so that gives us a smoother curve. And then we actually define the geometry itself. So as I mentioned, it's a square lattice, and that's essentially the default value. So we don't actually have to define it too explicitly, but we can basically define this geometry lattice where we have a size of 1 in the x and y directions, which is pretty much the default anyway. But we say that the size in the z direction is no size because it's only a 2D calculation. And so then that forces MPB to be aware that we should have a mirror plane symmetry in the z direction as well when we choose a no size. And then in the lateral direction, we just wanted to find a single material that has a refractive index or epsilon that's not equal to 1. And this is going to be a cylinder that's made out of a high dielectric, say silicon or something. And it has a radius of 0.2, has a center of 0. We give it a height of infinity just because there's no specific height associated with it. And then we define the epsilon here using this syntax. And then we set the resolution of the calculation to be 32 grid points per unit distance. And then if we run this calculation using a command line interface, we type MPB, which is the name of the executable, and then the name of the control file, which we previously showed you, which we'll call square rods or sqrods.ctl. Then the output that you would get from this would give us first like this line, which is kind of a guide to make sure that you understand what the output looks like. And then just exerting from the output, we might have lines that kind of look like this, where it first shows us like the index of the k value that we're looking at, the values of k in each direction, the total magnitude, and then all the band frequencies that we had calculated. And then once it's done, it also will go through all of those different bands that were calculated at each k, and then it can calculate the gaps. And you notice that there's a very large gap for the case of the TE modes in the square lattice of rods between bands 1 and 2, and then a much smaller gap between 4 and 5. Now, similarly, we could also do a triangular lattice, of course. In the triangular lattice, it's very similar conceptually, except now we have to define a basis that's non Cartesian. And so here we're defining the basis in within the geometry lattice parameter to have two directions that are essentially separated by, you know, plus or minus 60 degrees. And then you can see that a lot of the other commands are very similar, but of course we've changed the k values to use the so-called k point instead of the x point that we had earlier. And then you can see also that we might output the E field to see kind of what it looks like, as well as the epsilon. In the next lecture, we'll actually look at the results of running this triangular lattice calculation.